So you will get 2/4. So entire CT, the total equivalent capacitance will you will get as 4/2. That will be 2 microfarad. Right. Okay. We will switch to next. This is again one sum. Try to solve whenever you get time. Right. This is an important sum. Okay. You can note this sum. If you see C1, C2, C3 are in parallel combination, then again C4, C5 are in parallel combination, and those two parallel combination again they will be in series, right? So those we can solve with the help with the concept of series and parallel operation of capacitors. Next question is like this only. C1, C2, C3 are in series combination. So using the series operation of capacitors, then we'll get the total capacitance, and then C4 and C5 are in parallel combination, right? So using the concept of parallel operation of capacitors, finally those will be in series. Okay, we'll solve one more example. If you see circuit, there is a capacitor C1, C2, those they are in series, and then C3 is in parallel with C1 and C2, right? There is a point A and B in between them, and then there is a capacitor C4, and at the end there is a point that we have mentioned is C, right? So what we have to do is capacitor values are given. C1 has 60 microfarad, C2 has 20 microfarad, C3 has 9 microfarad, and C4 has 12 microfarad, right? If you note, the unit of this capacitance is normally in microfarad, right? They don't come generally in farad, right? Okay, if the potential difference, it is given that if the potential difference between points A and B is 120 volts, what we have to do is we have to find the charge on the second capacitor, of the second capacitor, right? So how to solve it? Okay, if you see, using the same concept of series and parallel combination of capacitors, C1 and C2 are in series, so we will get the total combination of this C1 and C2 as 1 upon C12 equal to 1 upon C1 plus 1 upon C2. So you will get total capacitance C12, that will be equal to 15 microfarad. Again, if you see, this 1,2 again it is in parallel with C3. So C3 and C12 are in parallel, right? So we will get total capacitance C123, that will be C12 plus C3. That will get 15 plus 9, that will be equal to 24 microfarad, right? Okay, now this C123, that is the parallel, that is the equivalent capacitance of C1, C2, C3. Again, it is in series with C4, right? So you will get the total capacitance 1 upon C equivalent, that will be equal to 1 upon C123 that we calculated earlier, plus 1 upon C4. So the total capacitance that we are going to get is C equivalent will be equal to 8 microfarad, right? So the total charge on the system will be, as we know the equation Q equal to CV, what you are going to get is C that we calculated, that is 8 microfarad, and V that is given in the question, right? That is the potential difference between A and B is given. So you will get 120 into 8 microfarad, you will get as 960 microfarad, right? Okay, now how to calculate the potential difference between B and C? What we are doing is, what we are doing is, in this case, we want to find the potential difference between points A and B. So if we know the entire potential difference between V and C, we can subtract from VAC BC, the potential difference between VC, right? Okay, so potential difference between points B and C will be same using the equation Q equal to CV. We will get VBC equal to Q upon CQ that we calculated, right? That is 960 microfarad, and C, that is it is given C4, right? That is 12 microfarad. So you will get VBC is equal to 80 volts. Now the potential difference between points A and B will be subtracting this BC from AB from AC, right? So you will get VAB equal to VAC minus VBC. So you will get 120, that is given the question, right? And minus 80 volts that we calculated. So it will be 40 volts. If you see, what we have to do is we have to find the charge on the second capacitor. Second capacitor C2. It will same as it will same across C1 also. So you will get Q1, Q2 equal to CV. Where V is VAB, right? So C we have calculated earlier, 15 microfarad, that is given the question, and 40 volts. So finally Q1 and Q2 will get as 600 microcoulomb, because the unit of charge is coulomb. Okay. Next. Okay, after understanding the operations of series and parallel combinations, how capacitors are connected in series, how capacitors are connected in parallel, how to solve the capacitors when they are connected in series and parallel, we will switch over to types of capacitors. Actually, the dielectric that we use determines the type of capacitor, right? Okay, common types of capacitor basically are ceramic, then there are electrolytic, polyester, metallized polyester, again known as mylar capacitor. Then there is a tantalum capacitor, there is a mica capacitor, mica capacitor, paper capacitor and trimmer, right? Okay, we'll briefly see all these type of capacitors. A ceramic capacitor, first one is a ceramic capacitor, it is so named because it contains a dielectric that is ceramic. Again, ceramic capacitors are again known as disc capacitors, as they are called because they are made by coating two sides of a small porcelain or ceramic disc with silver and are then stacked together to make a capacitor. Generally, ceramic capacitors have a high dielectric constant. The material that you are using, that ceramic, that they have, do have a high dielectric constant. And again, they are available so that relatively high capacitance can be obtained in a small physical size. Okay, ceramic capacitor looks like something like this. Okay, many of you would have seen this capacitor. If you see 154, it is written something is printed as 154. So how to calculate the value of capacitor? How to calculate the value? What is there written actually in the ceramic capacitor? Okay, ceramic types of capacitors generally have a 3-digit code printed on their body to identify their capacitance value, that is again in picofarads. Generally, the first 2 digits indicate the capacitor values and the 3rd digit indicates the number of zeros that we need to add actually. For example, if a ceramic disc capacitor with the markings 103 is written, in that first 2 digits, that will be 10, first 10 is there. So 103 will indicate 10 as first 2 digits and 3 zeros, that 3 zeros in picofarads. So if we calculate the value of this capacitor, it will be equal to 10,000 picofarad or 10 nanofarad, right? Similarly, if we want to calculate the value of this capacitance 154, what we have to do is first 2 digits will give the number 115 and then 4 zeros we have to add, right? So we will get as 15 into 10^4 farad. So you can convert that is in picofarads or nanofarad, right? Okay, next is the electrolytic capacitor. Again, electrolytic capacitors are polarized. They will have a polarity, plus minus signs will be there, right? And then they must be connected to the correct way around. At least one of their leads will be marked, either positive or negative, right? Electrolytic is not actually the dielectric. The dielectric is a very thin layer of oxide which is grown electrochemically in production. To connect or to contact the electrolyte, another piece of foil is used. But it is the electrolyte that is truly the plate. Okay, again in electrolytic capacitor, it looks like this. Electrolytic capacitors look like this actually. If you see, there are 2 types of electrolytic capacitors. 2 designs actually, we can say, of electrolytic capacitors, axial and radial. Axial are those where the leads are attached to each end. Leads are attached to each end. Each end means this one. Figure at the right, we can see that is the axial. And the radial ones are those where both leads are at the same end. Same end means the left side picture. Okay, it is easy, very easy to find the value of electrolytic capacitor because they are clearly printed with their capacitance and voltage rating. So if you see the figure on the left, it is clearly written, or on the right, it is clearly written 220 microfarad with a voltage rating or voltage capability of up to 25 volts. So this should be operated up to 25 volts. Okay, next is the polyester capacitor. Okay, polyester capacitor, again, we are not going to in detail about polyester capacitor, but what we are seeing is it's a medium value, say around it is generally available in 10 nanofarads to around 1 microfarad. Larger values are available, but normally that we don't generally prefer polyester capacitors, right? So okay, polyester capacitor looks like this in the picture that we are seeing. Then they are metallized polyester capacitors. Again, they are known as mylar capacitor. Again, they are available in several case types and tolerances. They are having very good applications, first in blocking. Blocking means we can use them in blocking DC while passing AC. We can use them as a bypass capacitors, coupling of DCs, and again logic and timing circuits. Okay, next one is tantalum capacitor. Again, comes in both wet and dry. Tantalum capacitors can tolerate a little reverse voltage. Normally their value ranges from 0.047 microfarad to 330 microfarad. It looks like this. Next is a mica capacitor, mica capacitor. Again, it is made of metal foil plates that are separated by sheets of mica. That is the dielectric. Again, why mica is used? Because it is an excellent dielectric and can withstand a higher voltage that even those paper dielectric of the same thickness can't tolerate or can't withstand. Mica is an excellent dielectric and can withstand a higher voltage, right? Common values normally ranges from 50 picofarad to about 0.02 microfarad. Okay, paper capacitor. Paper capacitor looks like this. You can see at the bottom of the slide. A paper capacitor is made of flat thin strips of metal foil conductors that are separated by wax paper. That is the dielectric material. common values range from about 300 picofarad to about 4 microfarad. Okay, after going through the paper capacitor, we will see next type of capacitor, that is trimmer capacitor. They are like miniature variable capacitors. They are designed to be mounted directly on the circuit board and adjusted only when the circuit is built. A small screwdriver is normally needed actually, that is required to adjust the trimmers. The process of adjusting requires patience because the presence of your hand and the tool will slightly change the capacitance of the circuit in the region of the trimmer. Okay, trimmer capacitor looks like this actually. Then they are only available with a very small capacitor, normally less than 100 picofarad. It is impossible to reduce their capacitance to zero. So what we do is they are usually specified by their minimum maximum values, for example 2 to 10 picofarad. Okay, after seeing all these different types of capacitors, where they are used, we will see the application of capacitors. Capacitors generally find application anywhere. Like first is in filter circuits, then they find application in electronic flash lamps for cameras. They are used in timing circuits for doing some operation based on time. Then they are used in power supplies and many more, right? Okay. This is one example that I have tried to solve in Multisim. Multisim basically a simulation software. When we don't want directly to mount all the components on the PCB, we want to check the behavior of the circuit, then it is possible actually. So what we are doing is we are using a software, that is right now I am using a software that is Multisim. What we have to do in Multisim is we have to drag all the components that are available in their library, and then we have to connect all those components, and then finally we have to run. So this is basically a circuit where there is one IC, and that is integrated circuit. In this case it is 555, there is a timing circuit, and then there are different resistors and capacitors that we are connecting, and there is a switch, right? And at the end there is a output, that at the output side we are connecting a LED, right? For checking whether LED gets on or off, right? And at what time it gets on and after what time it gets off, right? So this is the software, the snapshot of the software. If you see, this is a Multisim circuit, a Multisim software, and I have connected all the components, and then before running, the position of this circuit is like LED is off, in the off state, right? So once if you see at the top side, it is a simulate, it is that button is there. If you click on that simulate button, you will get an options of running which kind of analysis you want, transient and all those things, right? So after running this circuit, you will get the LED color LED gets on, right? The LED color. Once the key is pressed, that is the IC gets input, the LED gets on. The timing, that on time for the LED, it is given by the equation 1.1 RC, where R stands for this, it is given that R1, and C stands for C1, that value, right? Okay, next I will try to run one video. I will show one video. How capacitors can be used in filter circuits.
The output of the simple half-wave rectifier circuit is certainly DC because it never crosses the zero line. The polarity remains fixed, unlike the input waveform that crosses the zero line, which is AC. However, we have a major problem with this type of waveform in the sense that we have large periods of time where we have no output voltage at all. This type of waveform is called pulsating DC. I've added a capacitor in an attempt to smooth out the voltage variations when the diode is off. We have this 100 microfarad capacitor across the load. This is called a capacitor filter. Let's try it out in transient simulation. I have the simulation set for 1/60th of real-time speed. So we'll turn that on, and we'll see that the lamp is still flashing about once per second, but the lamp never actually goes white. It just kind of goes a darker yellow. So it doesn't actually turn off because the capacitor is providing some energy to the lamp. Let's take a look at this circuit in analysis mode. I'll select a transient analysis with 0 to 50 milliseconds and 0 initial values. And here's our output. If we look at the legend, we can see that the load voltage is shown here in red. The load voltage is the same thing as the capacitor voltage. What we're looking at here is a capacitor discharge, followed by a capacitor charge, followed by a capacitor discharge. So this is the up and down flickering type voltage that you see on the bulb. We'll take a look at this in more detail with some slides in the next section. At power up, the capacitor is at 0 volts. The positive side of the diode is positive relative to the capacitor. allowing current to flow into the load. Charge also flows onto the plates of the capacitor, causing it to charge. The capacitor and the load reach a peak voltage that is one diode drop less than the peak voltage of the source. Note that the load voltage and the capacitor voltage are identical because they're in parallel with each other. When the source voltage is less than one diode drop above the capacitor voltage, the diode turns off or becomes reverse biased. The capacitor starts to discharge through the load. When the capacitor voltage falls one diode drop below the source voltage, the diode turns on again. The capacitor starts to charge and the load voltage starts to increase. Charge flows from the source to the capacitor. Current also flows into the load. The capacitor and the load reach a peak voltage that is one diode drop less than the peak voltage of the source. As the source voltage decreases, the diode turns off again, and the capacitor begins to discharge through the load. The cycle continues to repeat. If we take a look at our simulation, we can see that our bulb is still pulsating quite a bit. It's not turning off, but this is certainly not flat DC. We can improve this pulsation situation by increasing the capacitor. I'll take this from 100 microfarads to 10,000 microfarads. And let's run our simulation again. And we can't see any type of flickering in the bulb. And the voltage here is varying between 9.25 and 9.18. Let's take a look at our 10,000 microfarad circuit in analysis mode. We'll select the transient analysis with 0 to 50 milliseconds. And we can see that the capacitor voltage or the load voltage barely declines between the positive cycles of the source. I'll go and select the cursor tool and we'll look at the peak value that we get. The Y value is about 9.3, and if we go along it declines very little, declines to about 9.2. So we have a